You've probably never seen an air conditioner that looks like this one because it didn't start out its life as an air conditioner. It started out as a hot water heater. A utility was doing an experiment trying to make people's electric hot water heaters be more efficient. And so they gave people this, which was a heat pump. So instead of having electrical resistance heating the water in the tank, this would pump heat from your basement into the water that was going into your hot water tank. In theory, it should be about three times more efficient than resistance heating, but apparently it didn't work out so good because these started showing up on eBay really, really cheap, which is where I got mine. But if you think about what a hot water heater heat pump is, it takes heat from the air and pumps it into the water, which is really pretty much what an air conditioner does. It takes heat from your room and pumps it outside, except in this case, it's rejecting the heat to water, which was perfect because in my apartment building, we aren't allowed to use our windows. Instead, we get a water circuit from the building. So here's the water circuit that we get. Those two pipes go up to chillers on the roof and give you in the wintertime, in the summertime, probably around 90 degree water. But I can't use the air conditioner that you're supposed to use because they're just horrible. They're so loud and they break and they don't work well at all. So instead, I adapted this guy to be my air conditioner. All right, let's start with the thing that makes it most unlike a normal air conditioner, which is that it rejects the heat to water. So this coil here is a water to water heat to is a refrigerant to water heat exchanger. So the water comes in through this pipe here. Then goes this circulator pump, pushes it through this black pipe here. Inside the middle of this black pipe is a smaller pipe that takes the refrigerant coming from the compressor. So the water is coming in here, goes around this loop a few times, goes back out to the roof of the building, and then the refrigerant comes in here. This is the high pressure gas line, and then it's going inside, it's inside of a jacket of that water, which is going to condense it down to a high pressure liquid. The high pressure liquid exits here. One interesting thing about the way this works is that the water and the refrigerant go in opposite directions. This is cool because the hot refrigerant is encountering the hot water when the hot water is almost done going back to the building, and then where the condensed refrigerant comes out, it's touching the brand new cold water coming from the building. So you get the lowest possible refrigerant exit temperature. Otherwise, this thing is pretty typical. We can look at it. Starting with the compressor, pretty normal compressor. Here's the output, the high pressure line. This is a service port that was crimped and soldered. Then the high pressure line goes down here, makes a U-bend and goes back to that heat exchanger that we just saw. And then it exits from that heat exchanger and then goes up here to a TXV. And then this TXV meters out the liquid and lets it onto the low side where it goes into this evaporator coil. And then it goes through the evaporator coil, comes out here, goes back down there. Interesting thing they have here is a high side switch. So this switch here senses if the high side pressure gets too high, and if it does, it just cuts out all power. So that will keep you from damaging the compressor if something goes horribly wrong. Another interesting thing about this is the low side gas coming down here makes this sort of U-bend down here before it goes into the receiver. I'm not really sure why it does that. If you have any ideas, please let me know. Why they didn't just attach it directly into the receiver, save all this pipe. Must be a reason they want that U-bend down there. Maybe to like catch some liquid, but I feel like the liquid would get stuck in the receiver. I don't know, maybe to isolate it vibration from the compressor. Let me know if you have any ideas. What are some of the problems with this design? Well, the biggest problem I've had is that the evaporator freezes up. It used to have a sensor here that would detect frost, and when it frosted, it would just cut out all the power to the compressor. That doesn't really work when you're trying to run it as an air conditioner. So I've been trying to do all kinds of retrofits to increase the evaporator pressure and evaporator temperature, try to get it above 32 degrees. I've tried all kinds of things, messing around with the TXV, tying together the output of the evaporator so that it can heat up the subcooled liquid coming in to try and increase the pressure there. Still, I've got it works better now than it used to, but not as good as I'd like to. If you have any ideas, I know what you're going to say. You're going to say, I just need to increase the charge, but there's really no way on this thing without really messing it up to increase the charge. There are no service ports. And if I start messing around with this stuff, I'm just going to end up releasing refrigerant. I don't want to do that. So if you have any ideas how you would get this thing. Oh, and I know you're going to say increase the airflow. If you could only see the contraption that I mount on top of this thing, you can't get any more airflow through this thing, practically speaking. So if you have any other ways you'd suggest me increasing the temperature of this evaporator so that I don't get frost over, let me know. Thanks so much.